I turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 2. As we proceed to study, Christ is the same. So, the lesson today will be the same. As yesterday. Okay, let me read a little bit. Though our circumstances change and dispensations come and go, yet He is the same. Unstable minds are so because they don't know this Jesus that is the same. I read the last one. Being established and stable in the faith is not you being secure. And that's important because we're always concentrating on us. Being established in and stable in the faith is not you being secure, but you coming to the knowledge of the life that you have, who is the same. The one in whom you are, who is the same. So, if this is a title for Him because it is Him, that He is the same, then why do we get shaken so easily? Because we don't know, we might know we're in Him, but we don't know He's the same. Isn't that cool? We don't know that He's the same, right?
Part of the problem is that I think people confuse the same with consistency.
Yes.
And that's why I dealt with that at the very beginning.
Yeah, they always tend to think that when they read, God is unchangeable from day to day, they always think that nothing changes, His mind doesn't change.
Right.
God can change His mind at any moment.
Right.
Being is the same.
Right.
And that's it. They're counting on the wrong thing.
Yeah, that's a good thing. To begin to understand God, God was such a religious term that, even a sinner's heard the term God. So I had to begin to formulate, starting from scratch, what God was. So I began to describe Him as this being. Okay. There's no definition in that. I need to know this being, this one that is other, this one that is called God, that is called Jesus. You see, we most people have what I call a warm fuzzy. I get the warm fuzzies. Jesus. Oh, yeah. Okay. How about this being named Jesus? Who is it? Now the breakdown starts happening. This being. All right. Now it's interesting that what Greg is just saying is that we look at this being and say there is a consistency about Him. Well, that didn't help you or me. Because there's not a consistency about us. It means that, I'm going to really mess up bad and maybe He'll come and pull me out again. I mean, there's been a consistency of, but I don't know that I'll even accept it if He does. Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, He can be consistent. You can turn down that consistency. But that still leaves you insecure and unstable. But when you begin to realize that this being, who He is the same, not what He does, but who He is. He is the same. That's a name. That is, He's the same. It's not, you just walk a tightrope because everybody automatically, when you say He is the same, they go, yeah, He's consistent. Well, no, He is the same. That's who He is. All right. So, now let's draw a circle around the same here and put you in the same. Okay, you're in Him because the Bible says, in Him we live and move and have our being. Our being. Not our doing. Not our doing. You don't have your doing in Christ. There is no doing that you do in Christ. There isn't. There ain't nothing in Christ but Christ that you do. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. All things that become good are all of God. Doing isn't in Christ. Doing is Christ in you. And you have to be established in the being part first. So there's nothing that you can do be what you are, you know, the Bible says in Ephesians 1, that you might be to the praise of his glory. He put you in the being of his Son called the same. And the Father has a heart that calls him the same, and neither will his heart change in relationship to the same. And you are in him. Notice, we were talking about this yesterday, notice I didn't draw you in him, because then you'll divide you from him and try to identify you. But I don't put a little you in there. I usually do, but I ain't doing that, because you automatically don't center on him, but you. But the reason why you don't see you up here is because you are hidden in there. You're not evident in there. You're hidden in Christ. Okay. But when he shall appear, you know what you're going to be like. Because you're one with him. And he is the being that you are one with. And you shall be like him. Why are you like him? Because you see him the way he is. You go, okay, that's the way I am. Because I'm one. Not because I act like him. Because there is no acting or doing in Christ. There's only being. And you must see that you are one in him. One, and he is the one. Okay?
First of all, they are one, but he
scripture, though, and you had that principle working in you, you weren't Jesus, but you had the principle of always pointing to the Father, always pointing to Jesus, and not your own will. Can you see how much trouble just that principle working in you could save you from? Whereas, could you see that if you were a pretty good, upstanding person, that you could actually be in more trouble than somebody, you know, not remembering that a needy person might cry, not my will, but thine be one, thus done, and he's, and that the principle is right, but he hasn't recognized the fact that, you know, even if I'm lying, I need to, but somebody that has recognized, not mine, but thine be up here, you know, yeah. Lord, I love to minister in music, but not my will, thine be done. Now I go out and I'm ministering music because you want it. That's different. That's a different ballgame. Then your life is being ordered of the Lord. And then if something comes up and it's the big, you know, it's your big solo or something, the equipment breaks down, you don't get all upset or, you know, or God, you know, kills the rest of the members and, you know, then you're out of a group or whatever. You know, you go, God, why did you do this? I mean, my will was your will in there. Well, you can see where the problem is coming. Your will, even though it's the same as God, but, you know, that's why one reason why we talked about the cross, you know, your will God is God's. You know, lay yours down and go with his. That's the cross. You know, well, the truth is when your will runs exactly the same as God's, it is a principle of the life of Christ to not lift himself up, to not glorify himself, but that the Father, that Father, your will be done.
Right? Well, you think it's a principle distinction that he actually, even with his whole intent, while he chose himself, should have chosen himself, he was separated from the Father, which is aware of what I say. Your will, he was clearly making the statement that he was not distinguishing himself from his distinction.
But he was saying, we are
the same.
You're absolutely right. Now, you know, we can jump off on another premise. This is the premise I've been doing. You can jump off on the other premise and talk about Jesus being the Son of Man. You know, as man, he had feelings and all this, and he didn't go with that. That's true, too. But that's not the premise we're coming from today. We're coming from the premise of the Son of God. That's the Son of God. His will is exactly identical, but to say, not my will, but thine, it makes it the same. Not just an identical, I want what you want, let's walk together. Let me tell you something. I walked in 25 years of ministry to a lot of people who wanted what I wanted, and the breakdown eventually came. But those that have gotten, you know, two people walking along and agreeing, you know, an agreement's a powerful thing, but folks, there's got to be something more powerful than agreement. The thing more powerful than agreement is called unity. Or one. More powerful than agreeing. Oh, I agree with you. You agree with me. Union is, you know, especially he who is joined to the Lord. See, there's you. Joined to the Lord is one. That's different. It's power. It's a powerful, powerful truth that if the reality gets in you, whoo, it just starts changing everything.
The statement, not my will, but thine be done. Also, you're not laying down anything. You're own. You're not laying anything down.
That's a good point. I think what she's saying is it's got to be Christ. So if you say, well, not my will, but thine be done, then it's Christ, the Son. Okay, but it's got to be Christ and he's crucified.
Right.
So when I say, my will is exactly what you want, you're not giving anything up or laying anything down. And you're certainly not exalting him. In a sense, you're both exalting the identical thing that you agree with. But when you say, I agree with you, but I'm not going to come at it from this angle. I'm going to come at it from this angle. What angle would this be from? A viewpoint of being in Christ. You see, it's a lot different than what we always say. Well, you're going to do this from in Christ. Get up the clouds. That ain't what we're talking about.
Chris? Okay, I'm going to ask you to see if you think this is all this is based on principles.
Right.
Okay, so I just like to throw this down right now. I'm going to apply it to myself. But I think this applies to a lot of people. you're not looking into the price you want to. That's where it's all mixed up too. So you're thinking you're seeing good, but you're still your own perspective.
And, you know, you may not realize this, but a person that says, okay, I want this, and God wants it, so I'm going to serve God forever. Now that's kind of what Peter said. I'll never deny you. I want what you want. I'll serve you forever. You serve. Hey, let's put this baby to the test. You'll be denying me before the sun goes down. Okay, I mean, you know, your reigns the circumstances just right. Some of us will have to take a little longer to prove this out. But the truth is, you know, there's nothing stable in just agreeing with God on this point. The only thing secure is him who is the same. That's the only security there is. You see what I mean? But we think, okay, because I agree with God, well, guess what? As long as there's what you agree on, God and you, where do you think the enemy's going to come? Right in between here. That's where he's going to attack. Right in between you and that, or you and God. Anywhere in between you and something. And because you're not the same, guess what? That's why God, in his infinite wisdom, said, I'll secure you. Not by being secure toward you, unchangeable, the same. No, wrong definition. But by putting us in the same. You talk about security. There's no higher, there's no more secure place. And this place is the same because it's that way in the heart of the Father. You're going to change the heart of the Father? I mean, it is. This is the way he feels towards this before anything's even created. He is the total thought and concept that I've got. And anything that you do might get you a little reward or, you know, whatever, but it's not going to merit the heart of the Father. That's secure. You know. So, I mean, I remember thinking, you know, praise God, I'm going to get up to heaven and I'm going to get mansions and there's going to be streets of gold and I'm going to get rewards and I'm going to have crowns and all this stuff. And then I was reading the scripture and it says, heaven and earth shall pass away. Heaven. My God, what a stable there. You know what I mean? And then I began to ponder and consider the true riches. You think the Father's going to pass away? You think the Son? You think God? No. This is the true riches. Right here, the heart of the Father. And in the heart of the Father is the Logos, the total thought concept of God. And he is called the same as in the beginning with God. It will not change because God's heart will not change. The Father's heart will not change, cannot change, will not change, nothing. So he is Alpha, the beginning of everything, and Omega, when it's all said and done, Christ is going to be all and in all. And anything else that was added, you know, well, we did this little hybrid of these plants and produced a whole new, you know, God's going to go with that. What? our little contribution, and in light of the world and the economy and the ecology, yes, it's all important. I'm talking before there was an ecology, before there was an economy. I'm talking about the one economy of God, his heart towards his Son, in whom he is well pleased. Forever. Right. So, you know, God said this to the people in the Old Testament. Will a mother forget her suckling child? Well, even if she does, I will not forget you. I have fastened you, it talks about through the nail scars and everything. I can never forget you. I cannot forget you. You know, it's a done deal. You, through the cross, have entered into something. We say the promise was. But it is the being of promise. The being of promise. Promise is you don't earn it. And so we exit that after didn't say it and go out and try to be good for God, do good things, do all this, okay? Instead of trying to live in him, live and move and have our being and learn take you, you feel upon me, ye that labor and are heavy laden and working so hard, servant, take this yoke upon you, come learn of me, for I am meek and lowly, you should find rest for your souls. You know, he said, come learn of me. So what do? We go learn how to please him. Which is not the same. And if you get, you know, so people read about Jesus' life in the Gospels, they try to copy Jesus. You know, they try to copy Jesus' message. But they're not really copying the same, they're copying the works of the same. Which makes it, even if you did it exactly like that, you can do identical works, but they're not the same works. Right? So, it really changes your whole perspective when you begin to see who the saying is, and we haven't even stuck Jesus as a name on this deal. We've only stuck two titles on this deal. What are they? The words and the saying, of course, and the word is the beginning. The saying is the beginning. But the word and the saying is all that's there. So, even to me, you know, I'm going to put it this way now, there's a whole understanding that this class is not bringing out. But even to know him as Jesus is a lesser knowledge. Now, if we're going to talk about the kingdom of God, well, he is the man that has brought in the kingdom, and his name is Jesus Christ. And in the name of Jesus Christ, there's power. That's a whole other character. We're talking about before there was a kingdom, before there was a fallen race, before there was a devil, before there was any of this stuff, he was the same. He was the complete thought concept of God. And so, you know, they say, well, I'll never be good enough. That's right. So God put you in him. Well, I'll never know that much. That's right. So God put you in him. Well, I'll never be able to, you know, measure up. That's right. So God put you in him. And God is, you know, I mean, you talk about it. Loving and caring and for you. You know what I mean? I mean, this is, you know, this is way better than sticking with you through thick and thin. Being consistent, right? Which we call the same, but it's not. It's consistency. But the same, he didn't be the same for you. He'd be the same, you'd be in it. Right? Right, just like that.
Sure.
And of course, the truth is that death only works through identification. Because you're not, I mean, you're not dead. He died. You were in. Did you ever see you die? No. Did you see him die? In the Word of God, it said, so you know that he died. And if he died, and you were in him, what happened to you? The example I always use is, I take my comb and I stick it inside this Bible, and I mail it to Georgia. Where's my comb going to end up? Did I mail my comb to Georgia? No, I mailed my Bible to Georgia. Where was my comb? It was in my Bible. Yeah, that principle must really work.
I've tried to wrestle with that identification thing the last week or two, because every time my concept of identification is the very same thing we're talking about is being with.
Yeah.
And I've tried to wrestle with that, and my identification is I'm by faith I receive my being in Christ.
Right.
Rather than trying to take me out of it.
Yeah.
Because my concept of identification is still includes me.
Yeah. And it's particularly centered on me.
Yeah. And
identification really says that's me in that sense.
Yeah, but see that's some true identification, but because of my concept of what identification is, I always include me somewhere. And so I try to take that out, and so it's I receive by faith my identification or my being in Christ. So I can take me out of it.
Because I know when I was wrestling with being dead with Christ, or being dead, because we're talking, being dead, if you're dead, then I'd see the question go, look very dead, okay, but I'm dead because Randy said I'm dead, some preacher said I'm dead, I read a book and it said I'm dead, or whatever. And I really, really wrestled with that, and I kept, so I'd go, okay, well, I just need to die to that. And I kept saying the scriptures said you're dead. So I'm going back and forth, but and finally that little concept of the column in the book thing really helped me to understand that the scriptures, when it talks about me being dead, doesn't even talk about me. It actually talks about Christ's death, and that I'm included in that. And if I don't include myself by faith and believe that that is true, whether I see it or not, that is. See, here we go back to my terminology, but that is my reality. No, not just that is a reality because I believe that it was a reality and it really is real. That's not your reality, you believe that's a reality. But for it to be your reality is an identification thing. That happened to me. Well, I explain so-and-so. Well, I can't, but so-and-so is not in Christ anymore. It's down here. That's where my reality is. So I don't need to get some sort of tete-a-tete, as you say, brother or sister or, whatever. You just hope. But you see, you read there in Romans 6, and there's no mention of you, there's no mention of the devil, there's no mention of, all it is Christ going to the cross and taking the old man there. And I was in the old man, then I was in Christ, then I was dead, then Christ my life. Those aren't just little concepts. They have to be believed. And if you believe them, they have power. The only thing we're ever required of you is faith. Right? No?
I learned that you appreciate people that you brought up about a big question of education because I was kind of the same thing. People would teach me about other words for faith or belief, although they are incorporated in that. And agreement is to obey or to submit to the reality or the word or whatever. And if the word says that I'm in Christ, then I'm in Christ.
Right.
You submit yourself, let that's the word becoming
that look very similar to the same, but they're not the same. And you may not be, you may be producing things right now that aren't very much like him, but you are obeying the truth, because the truth says I am in Christ, and I will stay here until this manifests, because God said it will, and that's what, this is the word of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Paul said, this is the gospel that we preach. This is it. You know, that got really bad perverted because of the little term that they use is word of faith, and it's in there. This is the word of faith. Well, folks, I got this one. This is the word of faith. And it ain't, doesn't include a Cadillac or not one big house or anything. It is, if you are in Christ, swallowed up with him, swamped, he is so big that you can't, you couldn't even find yourself in there. And once you really begin to understand the truth, nor do you want to. You just want Christ to be all. And that becomes your, you know, to consider, you know, to start going off this little primrose path of considering, instead of Abraham, not father of faith, he considered not. And this is our problem. We always consider. Well, I need to consider, you know, how I'm going to da-da-da-da. Or I need to, you know, what you're doing is you're considering you. Well, you couldn't possibly truly be hid, man, because you're right on the open. You know what I mean? You're not hidden in Christ. Oh, but the Bible says I am, and I agree with that, and that's the truth, and that's really my truth. And then you start talking about yourself, and you're going, you ain't hid! You're blatantly open! Oh, no, no, I'm hid, I'm hid. You see, a man keeps shifting back between their reality and what they believe. Right? You know? Oh, no, no, I, oh, no. You're not, oh, you're trying to shake me from the truth. No, I'm here. No, I really am, and I will not be moved from the truth. Okay, now, how am I going to, you ain't.
Acceptance
of
agreement, though, is belief in the mental
sense.
It's not true belief, it's not true agreement.
Well, I would say to some degree, maybe it is, you guys weren't here, so it is. But I taught on John 8:31, where Jesus said to those that believe, if you continue my word, you shall know the truth. The truth will make you. The truth will make you. For knowing the truth, not believing the truth. And I shared on the difference, and I shared that it's possible to actually believe, and but yet not to know. Okay. I believe there's both cases. I believe there are cases where people have mental assent, because what is Romans 10 is full of that, where Paul is really having to deal with that about the Jews. But I also believe there are cases where people actually believe, but they don't know, and so the devil says you don't believe. When they do believe, they just don't know. Because knowing the truth will make you free, not just believing the truth. Jesus said, how do you believe it? Just hear my word and say, I believe it. How do you know it? Continue in my word. Right? So, if you have any questions on that, this is good. But you're absolutely right. For some people, and certainly Paul addressed that. Paul addressed that because the Jews, it was truly just a moral sin. It's very good in the scripture about not being mixed with faith. The truth did not profit. So it had to be mental sin, because faith is the relationship to belief. Now, there's so many bases you have to cover, you know what I mean? And I still have only read up to where I left the last game.
And when, you know, when they do that, considering faith, then things don't happen, then they've aligned faith.
Right. Or they've aligned their faith, they let the enemy align them.
Yes. Or this faith thing is not working, or whatever this thing is, whatever or not, or faith works.
Right.
Faith might not work exactly the way you think it ought to, because faith isn't you working it.
Right. That's exactly right. We always make faith something we do, so it's a work. But faith is something that you trust in, rely on. Trust and rely on. Faith is something you do.
Faith is the same. It's really crazy, because all of a sudden your faith is something that can't change, because it's not your faith.
mean, it's the only thing that is secure passing through this life. Anything that is found the same has security. And everything else, even when it's doing good for a while, everything that can be shipped will be shipped. So that's why we have rested our souls in the haven of rest, you know what I mean? We have found the same, and we cling to it, and we're not real quick to give that up. You know what I mean? Because it is everything to us. We realize that gold and riches and everything, there have been times of famine or times of war where people would give away gold bars for one little piece of bread. Well, what was more valuable? You know what I mean? I mean, gold is more valuable than the word man puts on. I mean, food is actually more valuable than gold, actually, because food can keep you alive. But gold is no more valuable than what you decide to value. What's wrong with us? Being established and stable in the faith is not you being secure, but you coming to a knowledge of the life in you and in who you are, who is the same. Not that he's dead. He is the same. If this church crumbles, he is the same. If I backslide, he is the same. If my family leaves me, he is the same. When storms come and you are in that boat and afraid, he is at rest. Earth will be shaken one more time and will pass away, but he will remain. There's nothing nor no one secure but Christ and all. But this isn't all people, but all that are in Christ. Amen. Because the one is many, and many are one. So there's only one secure. And the one is many, called all in some places. It says, as in Adam, those that all shall die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. So, somebody reads that and says, oh, well, all in Adam died, so all are going to be, so everybody's going to be saved. No, there's an all of that. That's all in Adam. All in Adam. Christ, all in him will be made alive. But it's not the same all. It's just all of this one or all of that one. But it just depends, because really you reduce that down to the you see, well, it's, you know, but you reduce it down and it's one X. Right? You reduce it all down to here, it's one Christ. You make it so complicated. Oh, I don't understand all. Really, most of this stuff, while it gets it all goes out from one, there's, you know, multiple. simplicity of this huge depth to, not just quantity, but profound depth of and everything else, but when it all comes back down, it comes to the water. I mean, it goes out in vast ways, but if you all bring it back in, it's just warm. The Lord's Christ, again, out, the old thing, all in all. There's nothing nor no one secure but Christ. This doesn't mean he always does the exact same way. Can he not be the same and not do everything always exactly the same? Yes, of course. Because being the same and doing the same thing is two different things. But to know him, to know his being, is to explain his doing. To know his being is to explain his doing. But to not understand his being will always have been a cloud in relationship to his doing. And that's just true. That's just the way it is with everybody, but it's particularly true with the Lord. And I know this because I've been on both sides of that. I remember, why did you do that? Well, once the Spirit of God began to explain the nature of it, and then you don't have to have the Bible and the Holy Spirit explaining the Bible. Then you can begin to live down here and see God move in ways that you might not have expected, but because you understand his being, you go, but you don't have a pattern of he did it this way the last three times, so he's got to do it this way this time. That's how I'll know it's the Lord. That's a good way to get to see that. Because you'll never be able to put God in a box. You can know God through the power of the Holy Spirit, but you cannot put God in a box of performance. Perform this way, especially since I saw you perform this way about three times. Now I have you in a box. You will turn up. You will do it again, this one. You won't be put in that kind of a box. But that doesn't mean you can't know him. But you're going to have to know him in order to understand his words, to truly understand his words. Alright. Things are different, such as life, joy, peace, but they're not different. They are the same, for they are all Christ. Right? He is your peace, he is your joy, he is your life. There are ministry Jesus says, I am, you know what I mean? There are scriptures that say, there are scriptures that I give you this, but there are other scriptures that say, I am this too. Okay? So, when seen in the eternal aspects, life, joy, peace, they are different. Joy is different from peace. Life is different from joy or whatever. But they are the same. So, if they are the same, because they are Christ, then the same is before peace, joy, and life. So defining this being as just joy, peace, and life is proper, but it is not broken down in its simplest form. You understand what I'm saying? Because why is this being? Joy is this being, but just manifested in a different way. So you can say they are the same. Is life the same? Yes. Is joy the same? Yes. Is, yes, is peace. All of those are the same. But they're not identical to one another in manifestation. The same was in the beginning of God. Joy was not in the beginning of God. Peace was not in the beginning of God. So, to begin to understand him as the same, not just consistent, but the same, the same was in the beginning. Okay, so it's right there at the beginning, and all this stuff is going to come out of this beginning, isn't it? Okay, so we can bring joy, life out of it, we can bring joy out of it, now we've begun. But before there was these things, there in the beginning, there was the same. Jesus, it says, he methodically made a scourge, went in and drove out the money changers. Another time he laid hands on the sick and healed. There's a season to heal. There's a season to war. There's a season. But each one of those came from this being, and he is the same, though the manifestation is not the same. But I've often said this to people, and it took me years to learn this. In my desire to know this being, my first encounter with this being was the way he manifested. So in truth, I began to not really know him but what he did, and got off calling him that. So that when he manifested as in healing, that's the Lord. You know. Okay, and we've already talked about the fact that the last days, the false prophet is going to work miracles and healings and stuff like that. We'll say that's the Lord. Well, okay. The manifestation is not necessarily the Lord. What is important is who is manifesting. Right. So what we do is we, each of us, like particular manifestations of the Lord that we have culminated together and formed as clay into an image of what we call the Lord. And this is just a fact. We've all done it. It's an image. It's not the full, it's not him. And in some cases, it is maybe manifestations of him, but not him. And in other cases, it has been totally taken from him and formed into a form that we call him, but it's not him at all. I mean, we made an idol, to be honest. Some people. Others of us, really, it is the Lord, but we have, like, there's this big clay statue that is the Lord, and we've cut off all the stuff we don't even know or ignorant of, and we've reduced it down to a mirror, and, you know, I mean, we've got a few parts laying there that we call the Lord. And the thing is we can choose pretty much what we want. So this is the Lord. So anything that comes along contrary to that is not the Lord. You know, this is where you get what we call denomination. Because in some cases, there are denominations that have particular aspects that is the Lord. Now, they might have left the Lord. I'm going now, they're holding on to the manifestation. You know, it must be the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or you're not even of God. It must be dunked in water, or you're not even of God. It must be, you know what I mean, or all these different concepts. Hey man, knowing a concept, knowing a doctrine, the doctrine of Jesus never saved anybody. The doctrine of Jesus never helped anybody. You know, figure the denomination of Jesus Christ and so on and so on never helped anybody. Here is the one thing that has remained the same in the heart of the Father. And to know his manifestations are great. But we need to know. know where we are, you don't even have to know. How are you going to know everything about him? You explain that to me right now. How am I going to know everything about him? I'm, 25 stinking little tiny short years compared to the Ancient of Days. I haven't even barely plumbed that little surface here getting into knowing what he's like. But you know what? The good thing is, I don't have to know everything about him to have it even flow through me, because I am open to it, because I have entered into the same. And that is where my identification and being is, and he can come out of me any way he wants to, and I don't always have to go, I don't understand this, or I've never, I don't have to have all knowledge for him to be able to operate or use me. I know the Lord. When he comes out of me, I'm just the Lord, and I don't understand this explanation or whatever. But I know the Lord, because I'm one with him, and he has every right. I mean, if I'm his straw, if I'm his branch, he can shoot through me any way he wants to. You sit there and you go, you're in the tree of life, earth has passed away, you're up in heaven, and all of a sudden it starts bringing forth seven different kinds of fruit. You go, a different kind pops out. Well, I've never seen that before. This is weird. This ain't supposed to be possible. That's what it says in the book of Revelation. It talks about the tree of life there and bring forth seven different kinds of fruit on one tree. We go, well, this ain't natural. No, it's called supernatural. You're not supposed to be who you are, natural. You're supposed to be in the one that is supernatural, and therefore the explanations are going to have to come from the one that is super, not from the manifestation even. You can get it from the manifestation, but you're not really, in my opinion, you're just prolonging how long it's going to take you to the Lord. But it's going to take a long time to see every manifestation of this thing and figure out, but you can learn somewhat. I mean, most of us had to enter into that eventually, knowing, and then you begin to see certain universal truths. I don't know, it's incredible. Well, this is open to the world. You okay now? Every time. There must be a lot of gravity. And you begin to see the Lord go, wow, God loves us in spite of our fault. I mean, I'm beginning to believe this after 8 billion years of testing the Lord. Finding out, I think he really does. Can you imagine in 8 billion years into heaven with the Lord, devil gone, everything else, and people sitting there all of a sudden going, I've come to the conclusion God loves us. You could have just walked over and just kind of asked him. He said, yeah, I love you. I believe that. That's your word. You are the word. Before you can. I'd have a lot to say in 6 minutes. That ain't what we said. I want you to play sword drill with me. Put your Bible here. We're going to turn with me to Philippians chapter 3. We're going to do this quick, so if you're not fast on the draw, don't feel bad. Do as quick as you can. Philippians 3 and verse 16. Nevertheless, as to that which we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Okay. This isn't saying let's all come up with a particular rule and walk by it together. This isn't saying let's all think alike and be clones and randomers to anybody else. This is saying that we are from the same and we must have the same to be one. You're not one. You're alive, but you're not one unless it's the same. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's got to be, when it says the same, this is not just consistency called for. This is Christ. The problem is we don't see Christ in the Scripture. We see subjects. You have to learn. But the same was in the beginning with God. So this is just the same nestled between two words. The same mind. But the same is still there. That's Jesus. That's who I want to know. So I don't go to the Scripture and go, oh my God, I've got to get this doctrine down so I can be the same mind. I mean, the scripture. Good. If you obey the scriptures, I'll get in the same with Jesus, and he fulfills it through me. We walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. Philippians 3:1, so look at verse 1 in the same chapter. Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me, is indeed not irksome, but for you it is safe. Oh, man. Paul, you just wrote the same thing all the time. All you ever talked about was Jesus. He said, write the same thing to me, it is not irksome, but for you it is safe. I'm going to keep telling you the same. I'm going to write the same. I'm going to speak the same. I'm going to keep putting forth the same. Because it's not going to change. I mean, when you see that this is what before and was there at the beginning and the end are the same, you are safe. That's why I said for you it's safe. You are safe to write the same. Safe. You know, somebody goes, get off of this subject, man. Why don't we get into, like, you know, love? How to be a good dad. First of all, you know, your human love will pass away, your love relationships, your marriage will not be done in heaven, all that's not, but this is going to be the same. And here's earth life, start here, ends here, the same was, and is, and comes. And so, you know, people might at the end of this go, you know, I think I understand it a little better. Now that I see the scope of this, why do you always? Bigger. It is preferred before you. It is after you. It was before you. That's what John said. 1 Corinthians 1:10. 1 Corinthians 1:10. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Okay, I want you to, right now, get ready, set, go, be perfectly joined together. Same mind, judgment. Ready, go. You didn't have another way. Not in any other method other than this one. Going the same. Then you can have differences without division. Because you don't have to be identical to be the same. But according to this, if you interpret this apart from Christ who is the same, then you are trying to be identical, and when you see a point that you don't agree with, you feel separated or critical, or you know what I mean? Something. And then you go, oh my God, but the Bible said I'm supposed to think about the same time. Oh man, you know. Well, it's probably just their fault, because they're not lining up with the truth, and I am. That's usually our conclusion. They're not lining up with the truth, and I am. So, you know, I mean, I want to have the same mind, the same judgment, but they won't get in there with me. But this is larger than us. This is larger than you. It's long before you ever was. Long after you're not, it will be long after you're not, because you can't do the same. Ephesians chapter 3. Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body, partakers of his promise, in Christ by the gospel. Now, anybody see any good words there? Words like in, by, and the same. You know, isn't that good? Promise, partakers. You know, the Word of God, broken down into words as they relate to the same, tastes so good. Taste the see what the board is doing. Okay, so, yeah. I think we just start savoring. Thank you. Thank God for your celebration. Verse 13 of chapter 4. Chapter 4, verse 13. The last one we did was chapter 3, verse 6. Until we all come in the unity of faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God into a perfect man, to the measure of the side, and yet where did it go? Verse 13. Verse 13. Well, I got it is a good verse. And really, it, you know what? It is talking about the same. Did you know that? Okay. Let's try 2 Corinthians 12:8 and see if I believe in chill out. 2 Corinthians 12:8. Because love and chill out is only the door at once.
Are you sure?
No, chill out.
Chill out.
2 Corinthians 12:8.
Yeah, maybe wrong here, but maybe that's where you should leave. I guess I did. Okay, 1 Corinthians 12:8.
I was trying to say 2 Corinthians 12:8.
Oh, good girl. Thank you. Probably the one who put this in the computer for me, so I'm perfect in the middle of this. And if you believe that, you are a great witness. Or should just turn to that word. I exhorted one of the 18. I exhorted Titus, with him I sent a brother. Titus, make any of you, walk we not in the same spirit? Walk we not in the same steps? For us to walk in the same steps, we see these little footprints, at least put on our feet and nose. Footprints. One more, so I'll try this.
is not.
That was your Trump.
Thank you.